morning. Are we here this morning? I just want to check. Glad you're here. Welcome to our Christmas service. My name is Jim Martin. I'm a lay pastor in your presbytery and a member of your church. And we're thrilled to have you both here in person and online. Just a few quick announcements before we get started this morning. We do have our youth and family Christmas party this Wednesday, December 13th at 6:30. We'd love for you to sign up either online or we have a sign-up sheet in the lobby, and we'd love for all of you parents to come. Next Sunday, December 17th at 5 o'clock, we're going to have a Blue Christmas service. And that is a service of gentle, contemplative thinking and thoughts about those that you've loved, that you are no longer here, or other reasons that you have to be blue. Please come, and it's open to anybody in our community. It's not just for our church members. So if you know someone, encourage them to come. Also, mark your calendar for Christmas Eve services. We'll have two services Christmas Eve, one at 4 and one at 6. There will not be a morning service on Christmas Eve, but we're looking forward to that evening. And now let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Thank you. Good morning again, Evergreen. Welcome to worship at Evergreen Church on this second Sunday of Advent. This is the season in which we remember not just what God has already done by sending Christ into the world, but we also look forward to God's promise to complete his kingdom work by sending Christ again. However you are joining us, here or online, we are delighted to share our worship with you this morning. As we begin, if you are able, let's stand together for the call to worship. And I'll begin by saying, just a few more weeks till Christmas. I've got some of the shopping done. The boxes of decorations are out. We're on our way. There is so much more to be done. I've got junk to clean up, stuff to sort through, floors to be cleaned. Have you seen my closet or my garage? I'm not ready yet. I'm not ready. We're not ready. Today we light the second candle of the Advent wreath to remind us that time is short. Thank you. Our prayer today is a call and response prayer. So as we pray together using the words on the screen, let us seek the Lord with all our hearts, knowing that even though we are saved and justified by the blood of Jesus shed on the cross for us, we still sin every day. Let us pray together and seek the grace God so generously offers us. I'll start by saying, God of love, all year long we pursue power, money, and safety. We are obsessed with more stuff, new stuff, better stuff, more for us. For the sake of our Lord Jesus, who comes along among us full of grace and truth. Hear us now, O Lord, as we confess our sins in silence. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. As we have stood before the Lord and confessed our sin, let us also come to the Lord and accept his forgiveness as we hear God's call into a life of holiness. Like the prayer of confession, the assurance of pardon is a call and response. And I'll begin by saying, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. Jesus has saved us from our sins and calls us to a holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. God's grace has now been revealed through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who has destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Dismiss the kids to Sunday school if they want to go, but we also want you to turn to somebody and greet them this morning and welcome them to worship.
To rejoice,
a time to worship,
a time to praise and glorify our God,
a time to participate in his eternal plan.
On the first Christmas, God gave a variety of individuals reason to rejoice, to worship, to praise and glorify. Today, through music and scripture, we'll hear how he visited an aging priest, a carpenter, and the young woman to whom he was engaged, some shepherds, an elderly prophet, and some men from the East. Each was told that God was about to perform some unusual and miraculous things.
Each was called to accept by faith the things that God had revealed.
Each responded with obedience and was rewarded for their faith.
They all went on their way with rejoicing and exultation, and through their praise they revealed the light of God's glory to a dark world.
The first announcement was delivered by the angel Gabriel to an elderly priest performing his round of duties in the temple.
Don't be afraid, Zechariah. Your wife Elizabeth will bear a son, and you are to name him John. He will be great in the sight of the Lord, and will be filled with the Holy Spirit from birth. He will go before the Lord to prepare the people for his coming. Because of him, many of the people of Israel will turn back to God.
A highway for our God. Prepare
first, Zechariah doubted what he had heard from Gabriel. But after his son John was born, Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and began to prophesy.
Praise the Lord God of Israel, because he has come and has redeemed his people.
He is sending us a mighty Savior from the royal line of his servant David.
He is fulfilling those things which he promised through his holy prophets long ago.
He is sending someone to save us from our enemies, so we will be able to serve him in holiness and righteousness throughout our lives.
The rising sun from heaven is dawning upon us to shine on those living in darkness and in the shadow of death. He will guide us in the path of peace.
Child who is the light,
God revealed the most miraculous part of his plan to a young couple engaged to be married.
Joseph, a descendant of David, was a carpenter by trade.
His fiancée, Mary, was a young virgin living in the small village of Nazareth.
God sent the angel Gabriel to tell Mary that she would bear a son who would be conceived by the Holy Spirit. She was to call him Jesus. He would be great and would be called the Son of the Most High. God would give him the throne of his father David, and he would reign forever. After the angel explained how this was to be accomplished, Mary, deciding to be obedient to God, accepted his plan with thankfulness and praise.
When Joseph learned of Mary's pregnancy, he thought it in her best interest to quietly break the engagement. But in a dream, an angel told him to marry her without fear, for the child she was to bear was conceived by the Holy Spirit. The child was to be named Jesus, because he was to save his people from their sins. When Joseph awoke from his sleep, he did what the angel of the Lord commanded him and took Mary home with him as his wife.
The story of the first Christmas night is familiar to all of us. The census, the long journey to Bethlehem, the lack of room at the inn, the lowly stable, and the manger of hay. It must have been a difficult night for both parents, having to face the birth of their first child in crowded, uncomfortable surroundings, far from home and family. But surely the pain and anxiety were transformed into praise and adoration with the arrival of that very special baby. When the angels had completed the glorious announcement of the birth of the Son of God, the shepherds hurried to Bethlehem to find the child. There, in a stable behind an inn, they found Mary, Joseph, and the baby. Surely their excitement must have been overwhelming as they knelt beside the manger, knowing that they were looking into the face of Jesus, the Messiah, the promised one. When they left the stable, they told everyone about their experience and about the child. All who heard it were amazed. The shepherds eventually returned to the fields and their sheep, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen.
Son, the King of Kings,
Christmas story does not end in Bethlehem. Some weeks later, after his birth, Joseph and Mary took Jesus to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. In the temple, there was a righteous and devout man named Simeon.
Waiting, always waiting. Mine was a life of waiting, praying and studying. The more I searched the prophecies about the Messiah, the more I dreamed about what he would mean to the people of Israel. My people have known so much suffering because of their sin. I believe that God in his mercy would deliver us from our oppression and forgive us. He would finally and completely fulfill all of his promises, and this he would do through one person. This person would be a man empowered by God's own spirit. He would be a king, yet he would be called a servant. He would be strong, yet gentle, sovereign, yet a common man. He would ultimately triumph and fulfill God's purpose, yet in the process would suffer terribly. All of this was a mystery, but God assured me that I would not die until I had actually seen this promised one. And praise God, I finally did see him. That day began like any other day in the temple. But when those parents arrived with their son, I knew I was in the very presence of God. This was the one, this child was the Messiah. As I took that tiny infant in my arms, I had realized that I was holding the promise of all ages, the light of God's own glory. Here was the very presence of the everlasting God. Sovereign Lord, now I can die content, for my eyes have seen the Savior. He is the light that will shine upon the nations and will be the glory of your people, Israel.
The living God, revealed himself to a variety of individuals. Each responded by praising and exalting him.
The same is true today. God still visits his people individually and personally.
God calls us to rejoice in everything he has done through Jesus Christ.
He invites us to participate in his plan of salvation.
His desire is for us to exalt him, honor him, and make him known in our world.
As we respond to him in obedience and praise, let's lift him up before those who desperately need to see him. Let our lives and voices sing to them of the joy and peace we have as believers in Christ. Lord Jesus, we worship you now. We come into your presence with songs of praise. Through our worship, may the world around us come to know you as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords.
Kings and lords.
Jesus was not confined to the immediate area around Bethlehem, nor was it restricted to the Jews. God used a brilliant star to announce the Messiah's birth to wise men living in a country far to the east.
Those learned Gentiles made a long and difficult journey in search of the child.
When they found him, they presented him with precious gifts.
In reverence and awe, they bowed down and worshiped him.
Father, we bow our hearts in reverence and awe. Lord, we love you. You are God, and we desire to worship and glorify you.
Who is the great I am? Well, thank you to all of you who have invested your time and given of your gifts to glorify God. This was a very good example of what happens when we take the gifts that God gives us and we express them out into the world. And so in this moment, I want you to be thinking about what gift God has given you and how you will express it out into the world to bring glory to God and also enjoyment to God's people. So this morning, as you think about that, would you pray with me? God, we are so grateful for the gift of voices and music and musicians and directors. And we're grateful, Lord, because they take us into this place where we, too, can join in the giving of this beautiful gift. And Lord, we pray that today you are glorified in the giving of this gift. We pray, Lord, that you're glorified in the giving of every gift, whether it's financial or just a willingness to listen or walking next door to a neighbor and sharing our mercy and grace and hearts with them. And so, Lord, we lift you up in this moment. We praise your name. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. I'm going to ask you to stand for the doxology, and then we're going to go straight into the hymn after the doxology. So if you would stand with me for the doxology.
as we prepare to go into the world, I think I'm on. There's one thing that I'll need your help with at the end of this service. Now, you people who are from Evergreen already know what I'm going to say. Those of you who aren't, don't. But what we're going to do is we're going to flip this room for lunch. And so what I'm going to ask you to do, if you are able, is to take the chairs, fold them up, and put them against the wall. Tables will magically appear in this space, and then we're going to put all the chairs back. The lunch will be served in the other room. If you are a guest, we would love for you to stay for lunch. We'd love to get to know you and for you to taste some of our fantastic cooking as well. But here's the thing. Before you go, I want you to know how much God loves you. He sent his son into the world for you. And so go out and love your neighbors and serve the Lord. And as you go, may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and in you today, tomorrow, and forever. Amen. If you would be seated for the postlude.